Welcome to CYS. How are you? I hope you are doing well. So friends, as you know that on our channel, we are covering the syllabus of UPSC Civil Services. And for that purpose, we have started multiple series on our channel that are prelims oriented as well as mains oriented. So currently, we have 6 series that target your prelims and 1 series that target your mains of CSE 2019. So basically friends, in these series that are prelims oriented, these are 6 series in which we cover 6 topics, that is ancient India, medieval India, modern India, and polity, geography and environment. So currently we have 6 series. We are also launching the economy series soon, so you will be getting more MCQs. So daily what we do, we post questions, we post MCQs of one topic, that is 6 topics are picked up. 6 series we currently have, and of each topic we upload a video daily on each day. So for example, today we are uploading the modern India MCQs. So we have already covered multiple lectures of modern India. Already we are on the lecture number 19. So we are covering the MCQs. So we will continue these series till 31st May. So why the date chosen has been 31st May? Because on 2nd June is your prelims of UPSC CSE 2019, and we will end this series only one day before your prelims exam. So we have just 10 questions in this PDF that we are in this lecture that we discussed. But from next week we will increase the number of questions, that is we will take their number to 20, so that you can practice effectively before exam and comprehensively. So let's start our discussion. The first question is, the Woods Dispatch 1854 came to India with which of the following objectives? First, deciphering ancient Indian texts to bring out their relevance to the modern society. Second, to educate the natives of India so that a class of public servants could be created. Three, to develop practical and vocational skills to the Indians to promote to increase production in India. Fourth, promote education free of cost in India. So friends, you have to tell which of the following statements are correct. So let me tell you that first is incorrect. First statement is incorrect because its objective was not to decipher ancient Indian text and to promote the kind of, we can say, traditional learning in India. So first is totally incorrect, and similarly fourth is also incorrect because it does not promote advocated the promotion of free education. It advocated grant in aid system and also staunchly supported the contention that the students must pay fee in the schools for education. But second and third statements are correct. First and fourth are incorrect, but the second and third are correct. That is, second is to educate the natives so that a class of public servants could be created, and also to develop vocational and practical skills to increase production in India, then creating demand for the goods that it is not in India, it must be British, to develop practical and vocational skills of the Indians to increase production in British, and also to create demand for the British goods. So the answer is that is second and third only statements are correct. So thus clearly the correct option is A, that is 2 and 3 only. So here is solution, that is A, and here is justification. So basically its objective was to impart Western education and to educate natives of India so that a class of public servants could be created, and to promote intellectual development and to raise the moral character of younger generation. Other objectives were to develop practical and vocational skills so that more and more articles could be produced, and also to create a demand or good market for consumption of those goods. And it also recommended a sanction of a grant in aid system, but it argued that schools must charge fees from their students. So basically they emphasized on the practical benefits of European learning. Earlier the focus was on Oriental learning, that is on the traditional learning, but now the British officials changed their approach. They thought of the practical utility of the teaching the European learning, so that Indians could recognize the advantages that flow from the expansion of trade and commerce, and also to make them see the importance of developing the resources of country, and also to introduce them to European ways of life and taste, so that the demand could be created for the British goods. So this dispatch, after this dispatch, several measures were introduced, and education departments were set up to extend control over all other matters of regarding education, and steps were also taken to establish a system of university education. So let's move on to second question. The second question is, consider the following statements. First is, William Jones was the founder of Asiatic Society of Bengal and started a journal, Asiatic Researchers. Second is, Henry Thomas Colebrooke was associated with Royal Asiatic Society and Royal Astronomical Society. So friends, we have to choose which of the following above statements are correct. So let me tell you that both 1 and 2 are correct. That the William Jones, he was very influenced by the ancient culture of India, and for promoting a dedicated study of the Oriental, for promoting Oriental learning, he founded the Asiatic Society of Bengal, and he also started a journal named Asiatic Researchers. And Henry Thomas Colebrooke is also associated with Royal Asiatic Society and Royal Astronomical Society. And after after William Jones, the work of the William Jones, which was incomplete, was picked up by the Henry Thomas Colebrooke after William Jones. So both 1 and 2 are correct. So the correct statement is, correct answer is C, that is both 1 and 2. So the solution is C. So here is justification, that they came to represent a particular attitude towards India, and they had a deep respect for the ancient cultures of India as well as West. And in 1784, Lord William Jones founded the Asiatic Society to encourage Oriental learning studies, and he took keen interest in Sanskrit studies also. So he is also called the first great Sanskrit scholar in Europe, that is William Jones. And he was also director of Royal Asiatic Society, and many of the papers of the society's transactions were communicated by him. And also he was elected the second president of Royal Astronomical Society. And also after the William Jones, Colebrooke began the study of Sanskrit language. So he mostly he started the study of Hindu law, which had been left unfinished by Sir William Jones. So next is third question. The third question is, the Aligarh movement laid great stress on. So this question is about Aligarh movement. The A is spreading modern education among Muslims, and then B, reviving and promoting ancient religious practices. C, re-establishing the caste-based order in the Islamic society. D, overthrowing the British government by use of agitations and not by brute force. So let me tell you, friends, you might have heard about this movement, Aligarh movement. Let me tell you that it was basically to spread modern education among Muslims. So A is correct. So solution is A. So basically it was founded by Sir Sayyid Ahmad Khan in the center of Aligarh to promote modern education among Muslims and to reform the socio-cultural life of Muslims. And also it focused on keeping the British people, the Muslims from political agitation against British government, because it saw the British government could increase the condition of Muslims. And also it's one of the objective was to decrease the distrust which was prevalent between the British officials and the Muslims. So solution is A. So basically it was founded by Sayyid Ahmad Khan, and objectives were basically to remove the state of misunderstanding and tension between Muslims and new British government, and also to induce these Muslims to new opportunities, so that they can get modern education without any compromise with their fundamentals of their faith. So there were other objectives also, to that like abstain from politics of agitation, Muslims to learn English education, and to promote an intellectual class of amongst Muslim community who will look after the interests of these Muslim the Muslim community, and also socio-cultural reform amongst the Muslim community. So this is about third question. Let's move on to the fourth question. Fourth question is, consider the following about the non-aligned movement. Friends, the statements are about the non-aligned movement, and we have to consider these. First is, it was established in 1961 in Belgrade as the conference of head of state of or government of non-aligned countries. Second is, the movement ended after the end of Cold War. So let me tell you, friends, that we have to choose the correct statement. But let me tell you that only first statement is correct. That is, it was established in 1961 in Belgrade as the conference of heads of the government heads of the state or government of non-aligned countries. But it did not ended after the end of Cold War. But yes, its relevance has decreased to certain extent because now nations are forced to align with one or the second nation. So even though it has still has its relevance. So the correct answer is one only, that is A. So the solution is A. So here is justification. So basically the main idea was conceived by the India's first Prime Minister, that is Jawaharlal Nehru. And there were others also: Indonesia's first president Sukarno, the Egypt's second president Gamal Abdel Nasser, and Ghana's first president Kwame Nkrumah, and Yugoslavia's president Joseph Broz Tito. So all these five leaders were prominent advocates of a middle course at the time when the world was divided into Western Bloc and Eastern Bloc in the Cold War. That is, Western Bloc led by USA and Eastern Bloc led by Russia. So this is basically about your non-alignment movement. So it has struggled to find relevance since Cold War ended, but yes, it is in existence. Let me tell you, friends, that Belarus is the only country of the movement that is in Europe. So all other countries in Europe, they are not the member of this non-alignment movement. Belarus is the only European country that is part of the non-alignment movement. Fourth is correct. Let's move on to the fifth question. So fifth question is, which of the following correctly show the differences in the views of Tagore and Gandhi with regards to education? So we have to consider the views of Tagore and Gandhi regarding the education, and we have to find which of the following was among the differences of regarding these the views of education. First is, Gandhiji was highly critical of Western civilization, whereas Tagore wanted to borrow the good elements of Western education. Second, Gandhiji was supportive of education via arts and music, whereas Tagore did not consider them crucial in education. So let me tell you, friends, that first statement is correct, that yes, Gandhiji was highly critical of Western civilization. As such, he did not criticize the education, but he was against the thing that the Europeans are giving more and more importance to the modern machinery and technology, and it is reducing the value of human. So for that purpose, he was critical of its of Western education. And but Tagore want do wanted to borrow the good elements of Western education. Regarding the second statement, friends, second statement is incorrect because Gandhiji was supportive of education via arts and music, but whereas Tagore was also of the view that art and music should play important role in his school, that is Shantiniketan. The science was studied and ancient science was studied along with these arts and music. So and Tagore in this way. This second statement is not correct. So the only statement that is correct is A, that is first only. So this is the answer. So justification is basically Tagore and Mahatma Gandhi had different views on education. They had also similarities, but there were differences too. Gandhiji was critical of Western civilization for its worship of machine and technology, whereas Tagore wanted to combine the elements of modern Western civilization with what he saw as the best within Indian tradition. So similarly, Tagore emphasized on the teaching of science and technology at Shantiniketan along with music and dance. And he was of the view that creative learning should be encouraged within a natural environment. And this thing was also similar with Gandhiji. And let's move on to sixth question. Sixth question is easy question. The Congress split in 1907 on the issue of. So here we have been asked that on which issue the Congress split in 1907: A, grant of concessions to All India Muslim League; B, increasingly religious tones in the Indian national movement; C, methodology of struggle against the British; D, economic ideology of state-led development of India. So let me tell you, friends, that the correct answer is C, that is methodology of struggle against the British. Basically, 1907 split, it took place in the Surat session of the International Congress. So there the moderates and extremists were the two kind of two poles which were fighting for the which were of different approaches towards their struggle against the British. So moderates adopted some moderate approach, so they didn't favor boycott, strikes and protest, but the extremists favored this process of mass boycott and other things like we can say the protest and strikes. So this was the main issue of contention between moderates and extremists, and it reached its zenith in Surat session of Indian National Congress, leading to the split of Congress into two parts. So the solution is C. So the already I have given you explanation in detail. They were opposed to the boycott. Moderates were opposed because they felt it involved the use of force. But whereas extremists were in the favor of mass protests, boycott movements, and strikes. So the after that split come and two groups after them and divided, and moderates dominated the Congress. And this is about your sixth question. Let's move on to the seventh question. Seventh question is: Indianization of British administration was one of the major demands of Indian National Congress in the initial years after its establishment. How the demand for Indianization was seen to be beneficial for India? So the question is that Indianization of British administrative services was a major demand of INC, and how this demand could have benefited India. So this is the question. First is it would reduce the drain of wealth from India. Second, it would lead to gradual separation from the judiciary from the executive. Third, it would have made legislative councils more representative. So friends, regarding this statement, let me explain you that the correct statement is first only, that it would reduce the drain of wealth from India. Because friends, yes, because there were many officials that were of that were civil servants and that were from Europe, and they were sending their large amount of their large part of their salary to Britain, back home in Britain to support their family. So there was a kind of drain of wealth from India. So if the Indianization would have taken place, then India the drain of wealth could have been stopped. So first is correct. Regarding the second statement, friends, yes, it was a demand, but it was not linked with Indian with anything like benefit of in fact demand. It is not linked for demand for Indianization because it is a separate demand. So also the representation in legislative councils was also a separate demand. So the only statement that is correct is one only. So the answer is C, that is one only. So the solution is C. So here is justification. Basically, the demanded a greater voice for Indians in the government and in the administration. They hoped that it would reduce the drain of wealth, and demand for Indianization was a movement, was also part of movement against racism. But regarding statement 2 and 3, they are not correct because they were separate demands in their own sense. Let's move on to the eighth question. Eighth question is: In the context of modern Indian history, Patuas and Comoros were A. Puppeteers and traders, B. Painters and potters, C. Agricultural and rural craftsmen, D. Traders and iron ore smelters. So let me tell you, friends, that the correct answer is painters and potters. Basically, in these Comoros are known as Kumhars in northern India, Kumhars that make pottery. So the correct answer is B, that is painters and potters. So basically, in 19th century, new world of popular art developed in many of the cities of India, and local various painters and potters began developing a new style of art, and these potters were known as Kumhars. They moved from the surrounding villages into Calcutta in the early 19th century. So let's move on to the second question, next question, ninth question, that is P. Shriram Illu is associated with which of the following? So friends, you might have heard about this person. It is quite popular. He was quite popular person in India's freedom struggle, and also he played an important role after in the formation of Andhra Pradesh. So A is 1930 Salt Satyagraha and Quit India Movement, B Linguistic Organization of Andhra Region, C both A and B, D none of the above. So let me tell you, friends, that the answer is C, that is both A and B, because he was also associated with linguistic reorganization, as he went on a hunger strike for such demand to create a separate state for Andhra Pradesh. But he died after I think 58 or 52 days, I don't know proper days, you know, after which he died. But I remember that these are in that line of 50. And also he was a staunch follower of Gandhiji, so he actively participated in Salt Satyagraha also, and individual Satyagraha, as well as in Quit India movement. So the answer is C, both A and B. So he was basically a devout follower of Mahatma Gandhi. So, and he worked for, he devoted his life for humanitarian causes, including support for Dalit community. So Gandhiji was also very, very, was very appreciative towards the efforts of Sri Ramelu. So there, he participated in individual Satyagraha as well as Salt Satyagraha and Quit India movement. So in 1952 he undertook fast unto death. So yes, he after on the 58th day he died. So this led to rioting, and after rioting of 3 days, the government of India was forced to create a new state. So a new state was organized on the linguistic basis, that is Andhra Pradesh, and this led to the kind of a chain reaction, kind of place, kind of, we can say, in which the whole map, political map of India changed by creation of linguistic states slowly, step by step. So after that, Tamil Nadu was created as a Tamil-speaking country, state. So let's move on to the 10th question. That is the last question of today's lecture. 10th question is, consider the following about Lord Macaulay. First, he emphasized the need to teach vernacular languages to Indians to promote Oriental studies. Second, following Macaulay's minute, the English Education Act of 1835 was introduced. Third, he issued the order for Wood's dispatch to India. So friends, let me tell you that first is incorrect, because Lord Macaulay was strongly against the Oriental study, and that study in vernacular language. So he was totally against Oriental studies. So first is clearly incorrect. Regarding second statement, regarding this is correct, because following Macaulay's minute, the English Education Act of 1835 was introduced, because and in this basically Western education was focused, and Macaulay thought that we must teach Indians the proper Western learning, which is kind of a storehouse of knowledge to which they could be exposed. And let me tell you friends, third is not correct. He didn't order the order for he didn't he issued He didn't issue the order for Wood's dispatch. So the correct statement is second only. So the correct answer is B, that is second only. Solution is B. So here is explanation. So he felt that the knowledge of English would allow Indians to read some of the finest literature in the world that had been produced, and it would make them aware of the developments in Western science and philosophy. And he was in favor of teaching of education. And he thought that it could be a it in this way Indians could be civilized. So they it could be it also said that it could lead to their changes in their tastes, value and cultures. And decision was also taken to make English the medium of instruction for higher education, and to stop promotion of Oriental studies like Calcutta Madras and Banaras Sanskrit College. And it was not the Lord Macaulay who sent the Wood's dispatch. It was the court of directors of the East India Company in London that sent an educational dispatch to the Governor General of India known as Wood's dispatch. So friends, this is all about today's lecture. If you liked it, please like it, please share it with your friends. If you have any suggestion, you can tell me in the comment box, and I will certainly consider your suggestions. And please do not forget to subscribe our channel, as well as press the bell icon, because then only you will get all the notification regarding important updates that we do on YouTube relating to UPSC CSE 2019. So lastly friends, let me tell you that if you want to subscribe to the PDFs of these MCQs that we are covering, you can do WhatsApp us at this number, that is 8968426481. So I have kind of, we can say, highlighted this portion. So 8968426481 is our number. So you can WhatsApp us at this number to subscribe to the PDFs of these MCQs, because friends, at the end of the day, why these PDFs matter? Because at the end of the day, you will not have the time to see 20 to 30 minute long video. It will be an utter wastage of time, because at that time you will have to revise multiple topics, because and at that time you will have to cover maximum syllabus in minimum time. So it will create a kind of pressure on your mind. So at that time you will not be able to read also the standard books, because that would not be a time to read standard books or NCERTs, or that matter, for that matter. So at that time you must be having some kind of notes through which you can quickly go through, so yeah, you can, so that you can revise your syllabus comprehensively and you can feel confident while sitting in the exam hall. So in for this purpose, we have introduced this question answer format. So it is the best way of revising things because it doesn't bore you. You see a question and then you go for its answer, and if your answer is correct, then you feel happy, and if your answer is incorrect, then you go for the explanation. And in this way you keep on revising multiple times the syllabus, because UPSC is not just about questions and its answer. UPSC is much more than that. While solving a question, you must also know that why a particular option is incorrect, why a particular option is correct and the other options are incorrect. So for that purpose you must have an idea. You must have the kind of explanation of the question, because solutions will not suffice in their own manner, because they have to be complemented with the explanation. So in this way we will be covering approximately 8,000 to 9,000 MCQs, or if you continuously follow us on our channel, because we will be covering these MCQs till 31st May, that is one day before your prelims exam, that is on schedule, that is to be held on 2nd June. So this is all about, friends, today's video. If you liked it, please like it, share it with your friends, and please subscribe to our channel, and please do not forget to press the bell icon, because then only you will get all the important notifications relating to UPSC CSE 2019 that we do on YouTube. So thank you, friends, thank you very much.